That's very touching. When he had these fellows who formed these chapters after Freemasonry became boring after the first 3 degrees, and then they started adding honorary degrees, and men were writing up their own degrees, they were trying to become something. The influence of the shrine, which links to the daughters of Isis and sisters in Allah, has to do with Islam, first of all, and started way back in Arabia, a long time before Freemasonry was ever even founded. They married way up in Algiers, is where they married, where Freemasons were in Algiers at a dinner and came in contact with the Hashima, which is a certain sect of men called the Assassins. They were Shriners, but they didn't use the word shrine. When they brought this into America, you know what it became? It became the Sheriff's Department. The word Sharif and the word Sheriff is the exact same word. And that's why the Sheriff is responsible for controlling law outside of the city, out in the county, where they have people policing the city. You follow what I'm saying? And enshrining them, what happened is, in the city of Mecca, which is the real name, there's no such place as Mecca, and the word Mecca is not even in the Quran, in Arabic, it's in the translations. But the city of Mecca was ruled by a family called the Quraysh, who take their descendancy all the way back to Abraham, and back to a tribe of people called Ben Kinan, which is the son of Enos in Genesis. If you look in the Bible, you can see the word Kinan. It's the exact same word in Arabic, Kinan. But it's not to be mistaken with Canaan. In Arabic, they say Kinan sounds a lot like Kinan. They're two different tribes, right? But they take their family back there. They lived in that area according to Islamic teachings. Geographically, they're wrong. Geographically, Zimzim is not in Mecca, not based on the Tanakh or the Torah. Geographically, Hagar and Ishmael were nowhere near Saudi Arabia. Not when you look in the Torah and geographically trace out where these cities were. As a person who went to school there and lived there and was born there, most people are being deceived. We'll get to that. So what happened is they had to protect people coming into that city. That city was like, let's say, Atlanta. It was a center of trade and wealth. That city called Mecca. That wasn't even the original name. It was called El-Kun. That was the original name of it. And so what happens is bandits used to wait outside because they knew that the city being called Mecca was a city of trade, and it sat way out in the middle of the desert here. So they would circle the city and set up tents, and they would wait for tribes of people coming in with caravans with spices and oils and such, and they would rob them before they got to what's called Mecca. This was causing the family of the Quraysh a lot of problems. So what they did is one of the great uncles called Amr, of the Prophet Muhammad, got together with a bunch of family members in their village called the Quraysh, which sits up from the Kaaba. And they put together a special band of men. And these men said they will become the protectors and the defenders of those pilgrims coming to that city. It wasn't Mecca like today where they're making Hajj or nothing like that. This was going there for trade like they're doing today. Jeddah in Saudi Arabia has now become a city of nothing but trade. Nothing religious about going to Jeddah. And Jeddah is only 45 miles away from Mecca, which is called the holy city. So what they did is they had these men, and what they did is they cloaked themselves in black. They wore all black jalaba. They wore a red sash, they wore a black imma or turban, and a black face veil like Hamza. And they lived in black tents and lived all outside of the holy city to protect people trying to come in. And if they caught a person stealing, they cut off their hand. If a person raped or killed somebody, they cut off their head. The Shriners back then became the judge, the jury, and the executioner all in one. But they were protecting the wealth of that city. You follow? Now, this went on for years, and the names changed. Eventually, they became known as the Mutasawwif. That means Sufis. They thought they were mystics, or the Fakir. When they use the word Fakir, it means to be poor, to be without wealth, or as we say, penniless. So that term passed over. You follow that? Being penniless, who lived out in the deserts under the tents of Kedar. Kedar means black, Hebrew word. and it refers to Ishmael's second son. Ishmael was the first son of Abraham, or Ibrahim, or whatever language you chose. And his second son was called Kedar. And that's why in Songs of Solomon, they sound black but comely, O you daughters of Jerusalem, like the curtains of Solomon and the tents of Kedar. You follow that? So the curtains of Solomon's temple were black on the inside, in remembrance of the tribes of Kedar, who protected all of the other tribes. As it passed down through history, these men broke off into groups and broke off into sects and moved into different cities where there were holy men called Sufis and holy shrines or qubbas. The word for shrine in Arabic is qubba. That means a place where a person is buried, a holy man, a shayukh, or there are many different names we use for them. This is where their bodies were, and they believed that these men were saintly and had powers. The most powerful saint in present-day shrinery is called Qadir. And his funeral, which his name is Sheikh Qadir, his funeral is reenacted in every shrine and temple. The whole ritual of coffin, all that is based on one man's death. Especially Negro shriners who have never been in the East, never lived in the East, don't know the history. They only got what some Caucasian comedians gave them, who weren't even properly initiated themselves. So this family tribe, therefore, I had to draw my mind, circular outsides of Mecca and protected these people for years. Eventually, they started moving over to other cities. When Ali, radiallahu anhu, which was the son of Abu Talib, in other words, the great-grandson of that same man who founded it, when Ali, who was known for wearing black like Muhammad, and Fatima married certain people from other tribes who could not be in the shrine because they were not blood-related, like Abu Bakr, Sadiq, and them, became angry. And so they wanted Muhammad to marry Abu Bakr's daughter, but she was too young. Her name was Aisha. She was still a baby. So in order to get into the family of Muhammad, they actually gave their daughter to him when she was only 9 years old, just to get her in the bloodline in hopes that she would have a baby and thus have a child by Muhammad and thus the bloodline of the other tribe, Abu Bakr's tribe, and that would be in the family line. Unfortunately, Aisha wasn't able to have children and never had children. So they had to come up with another plan, and the plan was to kill Fatima and Ali, Hassan and Hussein and their whole family, to eliminate them so that they could just take over. And this is how come you have the Sunni sect of Muslims saying that the first Khalifa is rightfully Abu Bakr, when the history of Islam and Ahlul Bayt of the Quran makes it very clear that the rightful successor should be Shia. So if you looked at shrinery from the Islamic standpoint of view, which they say they belong to, it takes you back to the Shiite sect. But most Muslims don't have any knowledge of the history of Shia because the invaders of America were Sunni. So when they look to find shrinery in Islam, they get lost because they don't know nothing about the Shiite doctrine. The Shia's migration, this is where Egypt comes in. The Shia's migration is when Fatima and them will be in massacre. Fatima died 6 months after father, who died in the year 632, because they tried to kill her. Ali and his sons were killed. Well, Ali's two sons, Hassan and Hussein, was killed. Hussein died at birth. And then they migrated. His name was Yaqub, the son, migrated. They made it out of Arabia, all the way up to Hejaz, being chased by the Abbasids, all the way up into Qahira, called Cairo. And there they built a mosque. The university that I attended, Al-Azhar, in Cairo, is where Fatima's family stopped, and Yaqub and them. Yaqub had like buku sons. So some went towards Persia and learned to speak Farsi and picked up the Farsi script. And they were trying to preserve the Quran because the Sunnis were trying to introduce a new Quran by a man called Musallim, claiming that his name was Muslim before Muhammad was born, because his name Musallim means Muslim. And he had written a Quran, and his Quran was in poetry. So they had to declare in Muhammad's Quran that poetry was forbidden. But by the time Muhammad passed and they had started killing all the men who had remembered the Quran, the Qara'a, they called them, they had to go from memory, the same thing like the rabbis had to do. They had to go from memory after they came out of Babylon. So the original Quran was lost except for what you memorized. You follow? And so certain surahs of the Quran, surahs, were forgotten. Certain ones identified with how Muhammad was really a Christian because of who he was taught by. So they threw those away, like the Nicene Council. And they had to borrow certain surahs from Musallimah, but that meant what? They had to kill Musallimah. And killing Musallimah, you now have brought into the Quran poetry. A Muslim will tell you there's no poetry in the Quran. But poetry is usually defined by words that end in rhymes or rhythm, right? I'm going to recite some Quran in Arabic, and I want you to hear whether or not this is poetry or not. Ready? Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Qul a'udhu bi Rabbin Nas. ملك الناس إله الناس من شر الوسواس الخناس الذي يوسوس في صدور الناس من الجنة والناس. You hear how everything is ending in, but in the Quran poetry is forbidden. So it's obvious that certain books from the poem Musallima ended up inside the Quran anyway, and had to be mounted and had to be made. But back to the point. They were trying to preserve the Quran, so these other tribe members were trying to kill them. Al-Abbas' father had died. Abu Matalib, who was the protector of the Shriners, was dead. You follow that? Hamza, who was the head of the Shriners, the one who came in and saved Muhammad's life, was already dead. So they had to leave Mecca, as they call it, and they got chased up into Cairo. When they got to Cairo, they met up with a tribe of Nubians called Bija, or Biga, some call them Afar, right? And they're called the Fuzzy Wuzzies. And Fatima's family moved them with them, and they protected them. And they lived in the cities where Mary and Joseph and Jesus was at, all down through Nubia. And they protected the family there, and protected the Quran. Meanwhile, at the jump again, Ali and them and went to Persia and made a new translation of the Quran, and it was in a city called Kufa. So the translation was put into a language called Kufic or Kufi, and it looked much like Hebrew upside down box letters. Meanwhile, Bilal from Habashiya or Ethiopia, him and Umar, another relative of the Prophet Muhammad, migrated across Africa and went up into Maghribi. El-Maghribi is a word meaning the West or Morocco. With me? And when they got to Morocco, they took the original Quran, the parts that they had, and translated it into another script called Maghribi. A little more complicated, a little different. But the Moroccan script is different from the Farsi script and is different from the Kufic script. None of the Qurans that Muslims are reading today are in the original script of the Quran. They're either reading the Moroccan script, the Persian script, or Kufic, and very few people can read Kufic because it's more like Old English. So that said, they chased them up into Egypt, and there they got exposed to the teachings of Aset, Asaru, and Hari. And because Muhammad's last wife, her name was Miriam, they call her in Islam Miriam the Qupti, or Miriam the Egyptian, who had a son named Ibrahim who died at birth. They had family to meet them when they got there. And these people exposed them to the ancient Egyptian doctrine. This is how the daughters of Isis, which is a Greek way of saying Aset, got into Shrine and Dome. You follow? It goes way back before what people in America think they know about Shrine and Dome. What they have today in American Shrine is not Shrine. It's something that they put together. Some Arabs in Algiers was having a party. Remember, they didn't have videotapes. They didn't have, like we have, cinemas. So people did more plays to express themselves, to tell stories of Shakespeare. They did it by telling his book, enacting it. So Muslims used to do the same thing. They would enact the stories of the battles of Badr and the conquering of this village. And so in certain parties, rich sultans or rich, you know, men would have actors come and act out what the rituals. And one of the rituals they saw acted out was the story of Aisha in the desert when she had her hymen broken by riding a camel, and how she deceived the adopted son of Muhammad, and how Fatima and Ali and them didn't believe that that really happened, and that whole ritual is reacted in the temple today, but they don't even know what it means. They don't know where it came from. They don't know what the lynching is about. They don't know none of the rituals. They lost sight of the rituals. As the daughters of Isis, you might have known by reading it. When you get to the handbook, they have the name Hes. There's no such thing. It's a mispronunciation. There's no such lady Hes. These are things that must be corrected, because shrining them is ours. Always was ours. And in our family line, all the way back to Abraham. And what's being done now is the same thing that's always being done. The Negro, what I call Afro Shriners, are being fed a doctrine that was really taken for joy, for fun. But inside that ritual, there were certain Arabs that were serious, because they belonged to Abdul Qadir's sect of Sufis. So when Abdul Qadir died, shrining them mourned his death. And they enacted a ritual in New York, in like a funeral service for him. And if you've ever been into a shrine in the temple, the whole thing is nothing but a funeral ritual of that one man, but they don't know it. But it gets deeper than that when you know real shrine. And it goes into the tribes and families that they were protecting, and the holy men and the holy shrine. And the ultimate purpose of shrine was to protect Isa el-Messiah from Dibd el-Messiah. Isa el-Messiah is the Arabic way of saying Jesus the Messiah. Dibd el-Messiah is a way in Arabic of saying the Antichrist. Real Shriner's purpose was, other than most people on earth who are waiting for Jesus to come to save them, there's always been mentioned throughout the Tanakh or the Torah or the Quran a heavenly host, a group of men or angelic beings that was here to protect the Heavenly Father. They call him God's army or the heavenly host. Shriners are supposed to be God's army. We are supposed to be here to make sure that Jesus has a smooth transition from wherever he's coming from, and I'll get to that. When he arrives, when his mother gives birth, we are supposed to be there the same way we were 2,000 years ago when Jesus was born in a man.